Good evening. Thank you for coming, and welcome to the Monday, July 9th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Can we have the roll call?
Chairman Lennon?
Here.
Councilor Guvenelli?
Here.
Councilor Jordan?
Here.
Councilor Ray?
Here.
Councilor Sherman?
Here.
Councilor Sullivan?
Here.
And Councilor Walsh?
Here.
Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Town Council reports and correspondence?
I have a couple items. First of all, the first information I'd like to report concerns the library. The library has started a really outstanding summer event series. Tomorrow night, the very popular bluegrass band Tricky Britches will be performing on the front lawn of the library at 6:30 p.m. Bring your lawn chair and have a great time. Also, the trustees have been scheduling neighborhood gatherings to provide information and answer questions about the proposed building project. So far, events have been planned for Brentwood, Broad Cove, North Mitchell Road, and Wildwood. If you would like to host an event for another area in town or are interested in attending one already scheduled, please contact Jay Sherman, the library director, or Ruth Ann Haley, the chairman of the trustees, or myself. The library is giving tours now through October 27th. The tour schedule is posted on its website, thomasmemoriallibrary.org. They are 30 minutes long and are a great way to see why the Library Study Committee recommended a new building. You don't need a reservation. You just arrive at one of the scheduled times, and a staff member or trustee will give you a tour. And I wanted to just remind the council and the public about something that the Conservation Commission is doing that I think is terrific. They began a series of Trail of the Month. There's a great article on the town website written by John Planensek, one of the Conservation Commission members. The commission is choosing a trail every month, inviting the public to come and enjoy it with them. So check the website and you will see what trail is next. They meet again tomorrow night, and so tomorrow night they'll choose the next trail. Last month it was Dyer Pond, and the month before that it was the Great Pond Trail. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. Any other?
Also, Lennon, do you want to acknowledge the letter we received from Katie Leroy, sixth grade student? She may be a seventh grade student now, but we appreciate her writing to the town council and talking about a town-wide car show.
Yes, I think it's actually really a great idea, so I'd thank her for writing, and we'll be in touch with her. Katie, if you're watching, thank you very much. Now is the opportunity for citizens to discuss any subject or topic that is not on tonight's agenda. If anyone's here to speak to something other than tonight's agenda, please come forward. Seeing none, town manager's report. Mike?
Yes, thanks, Sarah. I do have a brief report this this evening. First, I wanted to thank the volunteers who put on Family Fun Day once again, particularly Steve Culver, who's been the chair for, I don't know, 7 or 8 years probably now, and you know, has just done a tremendous job. And it was a very successful event once again, enjoyed by thousands and thousands of people from the community, and it was a good event. Secondly, the Shore Road path, I wanted to mention, is coming along fine. No surprises, not as many complaints as we might have anticipated up to this point, but people are now that they're beginning to see what it looks like and the way it runs with the contour, with the environment, you know, for the most part, you know, the comments that we've gotten have been positive, although there's been a few that, you know, why are you doing this? But anyway, overall, the project's going well, expected to be done around the beginning of October. Third, we just got in the mail the annual MMA ballot for their offices. There's no contest this year. The proposed vice president, who would be in line to become president, is a gentleman by the name of Peter Nielsen, who's the town manager of the town of Oakland. And he's actually lived in Cape Elizabeth for a number of years. I think he might have graduated from Cape High School. The directors proposed by the nominating committee John Butler, a counselor from Lewiston, Michael Crooker, the manager in Glenburn, and Mary Ann Moore, a counselor in the city of Callis. And, you know, if there's no objection, I'll send the ballot back for the unopposed slate. Okay. Good. Third, I did want to give you an update on, well, fourth, I guess, on Crescent Beach State Park. I received a call about 2 weeks ago from an individual in that area who said that there was surveying going on in the area between Richmond Terrace and the Inn by the Sea, specifically on where the septic system is for the state park, there's been a strawberry field there at different times. And they wanted me to find out what's the surveying all about. Anyway, I did call the Department of Conservation, the Bureau of Parks and Public Lands in Augusta, and apparently the state is surveying that property as a result of an impasse in the negotiations between the Spray Corporation and the state parks on the portion of the state park that was leased by the Sprague Corporation to the state of Maine for around 50 years and then has been extended for a couple of more years, expiring each April. You know, it's apparently in talking to the state, and I haven't talked real recently to the Sprague Corporation on this, but I had earlier, the state, you know, there was talk about the sale of this 100 acres from the Sprague Corporation, the state of Maine. Obviously, I think most of us read in the newspaper, the current administration is not interested too much in using monies from the Land for Maine's Future, bond issues, or any other bond issues, of buying land. It's also, while the Spriggs seem, you know, a willingness to continue these annual leases, there also seems to be some lack of agreement, perhaps, on how that goes in the long term. And the state, near as I can tell, they're sort of calling the bluff by saying, you know, we have other options. They're surveying this other option. And what this would entail is a road going down the middle of that field, then cutting over the park's maintenance road back to the parking lot. What you lose is the current main entrance of the state park. You lose, is for those familiar with the state park, the road goes in and it bends off to the left. You lose all of that upland area where a lot of folks cross-country ski. There's some nice paths there. And you also lose about a third of the current parking lot and that whole far end of the beach. You know, the Spraggs have been, the Sprague family, the Sprague Corporation owns the land. You know, they've been very cooperative over the years. You know, obviously, the Sprague family gave this lease to the state, you know, back in the early 1960s for the 50 years. But, you know, it's still, there's this element of uncertainty, and there seems to be a lack of agreement amongst the different parties. And I just wanted to make sure the public's aware of it, the council's aware of it. And, you know, what do we do? I'm not sure if, you know, we want to get involved in the middle of a negotiation. But at the same time, there do not appear to be any active discussions at this time between the state and the Sprague Corporation. And the current extension, the lease runs out this April. So, you know, at some point the state may be approaching the town to apply for a site plan approval to come to the planning board to actually put in this road. And, you know, what it would mean is, you know, that a lot of the character of the park would change by the fact that you now have a road going in. You know, and I think the folks in Richmond Terrace would be very concerned about that neighborhood. The Inn by the Sea and the neighbors around there would be quite concerned about that. But the other issue is, and then you lose, you know, by having roads cut through a lot of the backland of the state park, there's also an impact. You then also have the fact that all that upland is potentially could be lost, as well as some of the parking and other issues. So, you know, when I look at, you know, if they put a road there, well then, you know, they put a buffer along it to try to, you know, not have the road, and then people's views disappear. So, you know, there's a lot of different complicated issues, and I thought you ought to be aware of it. I did get one press inquiry from a reporter who's here this evening about it. We had a discussion about it the other day. So, you know, I'm not sure what's going to happen, but, you know, it's something that I think the town ought to watch, and, you know, encourage the parties work together to preserve that land for the use of the public. Any questions on that?
Mike, if any citizens want to communicate with the state about this, which department, which individuals would be...
No, Will Harris is the name of the gentleman who's the head of the Bureau of Parks and Public Lands. The Commissioner of Conservation is a gentleman by the name of William Beardsley. And, you know, in the buck stops with the governor, you know, in the end. You know, and I think, you know, we've read some of his comments regarding spending of money and other issues, and to resolve this, you know, on a long-term basis would require that. And I'm also not even sure the Sprags now want to resolve this on a long-term basis. They may want to do the annual leases, but the state is exerting a strategy, I think the best way to put it, at least publicly.
Is the property potentially for sale in any way?
The Sprague property?
Yes.
You know, I can't speak for the Sprague Corporation. You know, my understanding is that, you know, they were in discussions with the state, and, you know, there were issues about appraisals and other issues. I don't know all the particulars of it, but, you know, the Sprague Corporation was in an active discussion with the state, and my read of it is they backed away from the table just as much as the state backed away from the table.
Thank you.
But, you know, it's you get things from one party, you get things from another party, and I'm just presenting what I know, and I don't sit at the table, and, you know, and we'll
Is
see.
The state land potentially for sale?
The state park itself? No.
The field and the access and what they're...
Well, that's actually Sprague Corporation land that I described, that on the right there, the upland, that was under lease from the Sprague Corporation, and that lease is now, the 50-year lease is expiring, and that's being renewed on a year-to-year basis.
Okay. Anyone else?
Well, one other thing, I would like to note, Marion Guthrie passed away this past month. She served, I know, David, did you serve on the board with her?
Our paths didn't cross, but she was on the planning board for two terms, I believe.
Yeah, a good two terms, was chair during a large part of that, also was very active with the comprehensive planning process, and just was a good citizen, and she'll be missed.
Thank you, Mike. Review of the June 11th draft minutes. Does it have a motion? Dave?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any changes or comments? All those in favor? 7-0. Okay, item 106, 2012, the proposed charter change. This begins with a public hearing, so if anyone has any comments on this particular item, please come forward.
My name's Dave Griffin. Channelview Road. The only issue that I have with this at the present time is a 20-day period to get votes or to get petitions. I think that ought to be reconsidered. I think 60 days would be a more susceptible way to give those who challenge this an opportunity to get the 10% signatures. And I hope you review it for that purpose. Thank you.
Should we start the discussion with a motion?
There's no.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No.
Good evening. First, I'd like to commend the town for moving in this direction, which is about 180 degrees from the initial direction that it was going. I think it's good for the town. I think it's good that you're bringing things to the voters. I do have one particular issue, though, with the amount that was identified as $1 million that would automatically go to referendum. If you look at some of our neighboring towns that are very similar, Philip Kaminsky, Gladys Road. I thought you'd know me by now. If you look at similar towns, Falmouth, Scarborough, somewhat different, but different assessments. If you compare the amounts, Falmouth, which has $1 million amount that goes to referendum automatically, their assessment for their town is 2.07 billion dollars, and that's their 1 million assessment. If you look at Scarborough, a much larger assessment at $3.5 billion, they actually have an automatic to referendum of $400,000. If we were in line with Falmouth in terms of the number that we put forward in this bill or this ordinance, we'd be at $825,000. If we compare ourselves to Scarborough, it would be a low $192,000. And if we looked at something in between, it'd be about $500,000. What I'd like to see, and what I think would be fair, is to just take the current number, 0.05, which comes out to $850,000 to $860,000, and bring that number forward. And the reason I say this is that it's somewhat arbitrary to pick the $1 million number. There is a number consistent with what the town does now, and that would be taking a hard dollar figure based on the current percentage that we use now, putting that into the charter referendum vote at about $850,000. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and begin our discussion. Let's start with the motion.
Jessica? I move that we accept the petition for overrule of ordinance as amended, which would cause a referendum or potentially cause a referendum to go to the town if there is an exceeding cost of $1 million to a project with the listed exceptions. I don't know if I said that very well, but.
So just to be clear for the public, if you haven't been paying attention to this, essentially what this is proposing is that any expenditure, capital expenditure that the council considered over $1 million would automatically trigger a referendum vote, which we don't currently have. Now we have a policy that has, you have to do it by petition, and they need approximately 750 signatures, and that would trigger, and then you have to turn it in, and it gets validated by the town clerk, and then that triggers the vote. That has happened very rarely, needless to say, in the past, because it takes a lot of work and energy. So this, in effect, turns over the large expenditure items to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. That's what we're discussing. Okay, is there any discussion? Jim?
Can we talk about the 60-day recommendation from one of our citizens here today? It says here, within 20 days after the enactment of such an ordinance, a petition signed by 10% of the registered voters is filed with the town clerk requesting a referendum, and this would be on the $1 million, or is this gone?
That's gone.
Right, so I just want to make, I wanted to be clear about that, because that's one of the things that we're trying to eliminate from this, is the onerous sort of process that citizens might have to go through in order to have a vote on $1 million worth of expenditure. So,
I mean, for example, if we were to enact a short-term rental ordinance that a group of citizens did not agree with, that would fall under this first part of this draft ordinance or amendment to the ordinance, and that have 20 days as it's drafted to gather the necessary signatures to then get it to essentially a recall. The reason to have a relatively short fuse is so that we're not, when we enact ordinances, people depend on those sometimes to determine how they act or react. And if you have a 60-day window, that's an awful long time to leave something floating out there. I mean, it seems to me if people see an ordinance coming down the pipeline that they're not liking, they ought to be able to get themselves organized and to come up with the signatures to do this whole recall process. But we're taking the expenditure piece out of it.
Right.
Good. Great. Yeah.
Thanks for that clarity.
Yeah. I just wanted to be clear that paragraph one only appears, it's just language to bring that paragraph into conformance with the new provision. All it does is none of the dates, none of the time differences, none of the time dates change, none of the requirements for the registered voters change. The only thing that changes is the reference to, is the elimination of the sections or passage of any such vote, approving such vote or vote, which refers back to the votes on the capital improvements. So it's just bringing that in conformance. And the language that stays is of any such ordinances, it's all in reference to the ordinances. So it's really just making it conform with the change that would occur by not having votes, not having to gain petitions on anything over $1 million.
Right. Okay, good. So hopefully that's clear to the citizen that brought the issue up.
Caitlin.
I just had a question about, I missed the workshop before this and I apologize, I was ill, but a question of the thought process that maybe went through eliminating the language in section one that goes, basically all people can appeal now is an ordinance and it takes away any vote. So as long as the council keeps something under $1 million, the citizens really have no recourse. If it's under $1 million and we vote on it, then they didn't get a referendum and they no longer have this petition, from what I understand, because it just reads all ordinances except emergency ordinances, and then it strikes out the votes, any vote. So if we vote to spend $900,000, people can't petition that.
I think that's right. Right now, though, anything that's $1 million or more automatically goes to a vote of the citizens. So the only thing that we're taking away, I suppose, for a citizens group to challenge would be expenditures between the 850,000 right. and the million. So to get to Mr. Kaminsky's point, if we're going to go down this path, I do see some logic in keeping the threshold the same, the 0.05%. Of the annual valuation, because that's not really changing a citizen's ability to try to override a single capital expenditure. On the other hand, I'm not sure I like this whole thing, period, but I see the logic of what Mr. Kaminsky has suggested.
Just makes it automatic, basically.
Yeah.
Which goes to your point, Caitlin. It provides the same sort of protection, if you will, or involvement of the citizens. So.
Well, but not really. It's got a $1 million line, and so I was just pointing out that $150,000 wiggle room that we have right now, that it's at $850,000 basically was the line, and so if we vote to do something for $900,000, nobody gets a say on it, versus what Dave was saying, if we kept the threshold instead of a million at what it's been this whole time, the same threshold that it was to get a petition going in the first place.
I mean, I'll just say one quick thing, which is in the workshop we had a lot of discussion about this, and there was a huge window what other towns would done, as he pointed out, all the way from, you know, half a million up to 5 million. And we tried to tread a little bit of balance. We didn't want to tie the hands of future councillors so that they couldn't do anything without it going, and it's partly just a logistical issue. I mean, as we all know, it costs money to go to vote, and it's a lot of work for the town clerk and so forth. So we tried to tread that balance, and we also thought $1 million was a much easier thing to explain and for people to grasp than this whole explanation 0.05, and that's how we arrived at it. Sorry, what did you want to say?
I just wanted to point out that we're hearing this $855,000 amount as if that sort of set in concrete. The standard right now is 0.05% of the state valuation. It was, in fact, the state valuations 3 years ago was much higher, and we were in fact at $1 million. So you know, if this was done 3 years ago, basically the changes is you're making it to be, you know, anything $1 million or over, citizens automatically vote on without having to get the signatures. I agree that right now there's a $150,000 window, but last year that $150,000 window was only $100,000. 2 years ago it was only about $75,000. 3 years ago we were essentially at $1 million. So, you know, and by having it $1 million, you know, it is really equivalent in inflationary terms to where it's been traditionally and historically, except that's, there's no inflation clause in this anymore. It'll probably be $1 million for another 10 years. And if this was not adopted and you stayed with the state valuation, I think everyone would hope and expect that valuations are going to start increasing again sometime.
I am fine with the $1 million. I just wanted to make sure that that was discussed, because again, I apologize, I wasn't able to attend the workshop.
The other interesting piece of information is how infrequently either of these has happened. Mm-hmm. Number one, that people have actually come to us with signatures and asked for a referendum. How many times in the past 20 years?
About 20 years ago, it happened twice in short succession over some sewer issues.
And also that we don't too often spend over $1 million, unlike some towns that have a lot more money. So those two, when you put those two together, we're talking about something that's fairly infrequent. We just thought that it was the right thing to do. It enables the town to decide to have a bigger say in how their money's spent. It's like voting on the school budget.
And at the workshop, we also discussed the fact that we understood that citizens would be very, very interested in how that $1 million or whatever number was arrived at, so as to make sure that there's full integrity in what's being presented here. That to come in at $9,999,000, you know, just doesn't seem appropriate. I mean, we discussed the fact that this is clearly about citizen engagement, and clearly the fact that we obviously need to deal with it very straightforward.
Jessica, then Dave.
For Caitlin in the audience, just to go back to Mike's point, the other reason that we thought of that figure was, again, considering that the town valuation changes. And, you know, as Mike just pointed out, how much has changed in the last 3 years and kind of what those parameters have been, and that $1 million figure was a easily recognizable, solid figure within the range of what the evaluation has been fluctuating. Therefore, that would be something citizens would, you know, could recognize immediately, wouldn't cause us to go back to do any more changes for a while. So, Dave?
This is just a question perhaps for the manager or the rest of the council, but what if the council is considering a bond for over $1 million, but it's for 5 separate projects? Some road improvements, a new boiler for the middle school, a new roof for the town hall, and a couple of other things. Does that trigger this vote? What I'm trying to figure out is, to make it clear that a future council might say, hey, as long as it's 6 different projects, we can bond $2 million and not trigger this. And I want there to be some clarity as to what this is actually doing.
This maintains the current policy, which is the amount of money is for any single capital project. If you do, as part of the budget, 4 different projects that add up to $2.5 million, but none of them is over 0.05% of the state valuation, none of that is petitionable. So it's only, as right now it says single capital improvement, and under the new policy, it also is a single capital improvement.
So is there a typo? It says any vote by the council for a single capital expenditure of town funds or a single capital improvement. Should that be 4? Or am I just not understanding this?
I believe it's the way the attorney drafted it, but we'll make sure, we'll doubly confirm that.
Okay. It's a single capital expenditure of town funds for a single capital improvement. That's what we're talking about.
That's my understanding.
Okay.
Kathy, then Frank.
And just to make sure that it's clear again, because we talk about this a lot, school issues have to be voted on by law.
school building projects need to be voted on.
As well as the budget.
Even if they're lower than this.
Right.
By, if there's any borrowing involved. And I forget what the exact threshold is, but there is a provision in Maine state law in the school building section.
As well as the budget. As well as the school budget, so.
In the school budget now, it needs to be voted on as well.
Right, so it's not an apples-to-apples comparison.
But it's trying to bring it a little more in parity, Frank?
Mike, just to clarify, the distinction between borrowing versus the capital expenditures.
Yeah.
So if we have $1 million borrowing for 10 projects, each less than $1 million, that would not trigger a referendum.
That's right.
And that would be, to me, that's consistent with the spirit of how we approach this, that we weren't so concerned about the borrowing levels, because that's managed sort of independent of this. We're concerned about the capital spending of the projects that we're talking about.
Yep.
So
And I do want to confirm with the state valuation. The year that was high was 2008. It was $1,942,000. So it was just under $1 million in 2008. Now the state valuation is $1.7 million. So you can see, you know, when it was 1.942, we were just about at the million in 2008.
Jim?
Given what's on the table here, Michael, could you, the police station would have
triggered it.
The Department of Public Works building
would have triggered it.
The turf field?
The turf field, in and of itself, would not have.
Shore Road Path?
The Shore Road Pathway would have triggered this.
Okay, so.
But it wasn't a town expenditure.
There's no requirement. It doesn't say what the source of the revenue, what the funds are. Even if the monies are donated, it does trigger it.
Okay, good, thank you.
Caitlin?
Back to what Dave was commenting about the possible typo. The way I read it, any vote by the council for a single capture expenditure of town funds or a single capital improvement not arising, then it goes on. If you change that to a for instead of an or, it says a single capital expenditure of town funds for a single capital improvement. So if you change it to a for, does that mean if we decide to build a new building or create a new project that's not an improvement, it doesn't trigger the vote?
That would be a single capital expenditure.
Right, but if you change, that's why we're asking whether this typo exists or not. If you change that to a for instead of or, do you see how it changes the structure of the whole sentence?
I will go back to what I said earlier, is I will reconfirm with the town attorney the wording. And you know, this has to be dealt with no later than your August meeting. If you want, we can get that clarified. Am I correct, Deborah? For the balloting. If you want that clarified, we can do that.
Why don't we vote tonight on the gist of it? I think we're 99% of the way there, and then it has to go to a vote so we can in August clarify the language and what exactly is going to be put on the ballot and so forth.
Approve the warrant is what you're saying.
Approve the warrant, thank you.
Again, I probably am not going to vote in favor of this. I'm not sure I'm seeing the logic of not being consistent with the existing threshold. But also, I'm thinking about the Shore Road Pathway. If funds come from the state and private donations and the town's contribution is a few hundred thousand dollars, I'm not sure I'm seeing the logic of sending that to a town vote.
Let me explain. That is the current policy, David. This would not change that policy. The current policy doesn't consider the source of the funds.
Okay. So that the Shore Road vote would have been subject to a recall?
It would have been subject to a recall.
Okay.
And it was very borderline because it was the project itself, the grant was $729,000. The project came in, the bids came in at $804,000. But, you know, it was close enough with the engineering fees and everything else that, you know, we wouldn't have gone all the way forward with the risk that it was going to come in at a little over $1 million and then be stuck in a bad place after spending a whole lot of money.
Frank?
Mike, how about Robinson Woods 2, where the total purchase was north of $1 million, but that's actually not our transaction.
That's the town's expenditure is $350,000. It's not $1 million.
So it's sort of a contrast to the situation where the town's expenditure on the path was less than a million.
So what's people's pleasure? Do you want to vote now, or do you want Mike to talk to the lawyer, come back, and vote in August?
I think we know what we want this to say. We just want to make sure the wording reflects that correctly. I don't think we need to wait for the wording to be corrected.
People ready to vote now?
Yes.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 5-2. Can I ask that these spotlights be turned off? They kill my eyes. Thanks. Okay, item 107, 2012, Good Table Annual License. Do I have a motion? Dip?
I move that we approve the annual licenses for the Good Table Restaurant.
Second. Discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Item 108, 2012, Short-Term Rentals. We're here. We have 15 minutes for citizens to comment on this, and if it's all right, I think we'll go ahead and hear from people, and then we'll consider what motion to make. I wonder if I could start with the Planning Board Chair, Elaine, who, thank you for coming very much, to give us a little bit of a background and explanation for the what's before us here from the Planning Board. Thank you.
Okay. I'll give you just a very brief explanation, and I just had two points that I wanted to make that I'm not sure come through clearly from the Planning Board memorandum. The Planning Board received a draft ordinance from the Ordinance Committee, and we understand that the Ordinance Committee had spent a lot of time on it. There had been a lot of public input. The Planning Board took a look at that ordinance, and you will see in the memo that you have highlighted the things that we changed from the ordinance that was presented to us from the Ordinance Committee. Very briefly, leaving out a lot of details, where the Planning Board ended up is that we did vote in favor of a short-term rental ordinance. Short-term rental is defined as anything 30 days or shorter is a short-term rental. We added an exemption for rentals for any property that was rented cumulatively less than 14 days in a given year. Those rentals are entirely excluded from the ordinance. Any other short-term rental in any of the residential districts in the BA district or in the town center are subject to this ordinance. There are somewhat different requirements for properties of less than 30,000 square feet, although most of this ordinance applies equally to any property covered by the ordinance. The only difference that remains in the ordinance for the larger properties is that the maximum number of tenants permitted becomes a factor essentially of parking and sanitary waste disposal, but the maximum number of guests is capped at 15, whereas in the smaller lots, the maximum number of tenants, I believe we ended up at 8. Yes, the maximum number of tenants is 8, and the maximum number of guests is 8. Those amounts can be reduced if the parking and or the sanitary waste do not allow that many, but 8 is a cap on those smaller lots. That's just very briefly some of the issues. The other thing that did not appear in the Ordinance Committee provisions at all are various life safety requirements, and the Planning Board felt that this was an important thing for us to address if we are going to be regulating short-term rentals. The two particular points I wanted to make, you'll see from the memo that the Planning Board unanimously recommends this ordinance, but I thought it was important to clarify what that meant, what that means in terms of reflecting the Planning Board discussion and where various members of the Planning Board ended up. We heard quite a lot of public testimony at a number of public comment periods and public hearings We had a lot of information submitted to us in writing. After digesting all of that, at the end, there were planning board members who felt that all short-term rentals should be prohibited in any residential area in Cape Elizabeth. There were other members of the planning board who, at the end of the day, concluded that we should strictly limit this ordinance to the issue that had been initially presented, which really was only for very small lots with absentee landlords. So felt that the scope of what was being proposed here was well beyond the problem that had been identified and was well beyond what we ought to undertake. Despite the fact that that's what various members of the planning board concluded at the end of our deliberations, we also concluded that some ordinance should go forward at this point. And although I don't think there was a single member of the planning board who would have drawn the lines exactly where we drew them, we nonetheless felt that given the diversity of opinion that we had heard in the town, that we unanimously concluded that this was a good place to come out. So I just thought it was important to explain that unanimous vote. The other point I wanted to make that's mentioned only in passing at the end of the memo here relates to some of the most egregious activity that we heard about in the course of our discussions. Inappropriate sexual behavior on properties, fireworks set off close to property lines, cars parked helter-skelter all across properties and on the streets. Really inconsiderate, inappropriate behavior in any neighborhood, large or small. Much of that behavior is not going to be stopped by this ordinance. And I think some of it could be assisted by taking a hard look at the nuisance ordinance, both in terms of what its detail, its scope, and also its enforcement. And many citizens brought this point to us. The nuisance ordinance is not within the jurisdiction of the planning board. It's not something we considered, but we do note at the end of this provision that if we're going to address much of the most egregious behavior that we heard about, that something in addition to the short-term rental ordinance, as you will see it, would have to be considered. So those are the two additional points I wanted to make tonight. And if you have any questions, that's great. Either myself or another representative of the planning board would plan to meet with the ordinance committee when they get into the details of the ordinance. So we're certainly happy to answer any more specific questions then also.
Does anyone have any questions now? Yes, go ahead.
Can you come up? No. She needs to come up.
How many locations? I actually couldn't give you a tally of that location. I would, the number there, I would guess 4 to 6. A limited number.
Sarah.
Very limited number, yes.
Excuse me, Madam Chair.
You can't have a conversation. You'd have to come up to the podium, and then she would come up. So we'll save that till the... Thanks. I actually have a question. Did you wrestle a lot or a little with the notion of dividing these out entirely and treating the smaller than 30,000 square feet as almost a different animal? And because you had mentioned that members of the planning board were very much in favor of very strictly limiting or regulating the small lots. Did you guys have that conversation?
Yes, we had that conversation quite a bit, and the ordinance as it came to various planning board meetings varied in terms of whether we recognized any difference between lots of less than 30,000 square feet, because there was a sentiment among some people that all properties should be treated the same, and there was really no basis for distinguishing. And as I mentioned before, there was a sentiment that really short-term rentals were incompatible with residential uses, and it didn't matter the size of lots involved. But I think at the end of the discussion, as it finally turned out, it seemed that there really were qualitative differences in the impact on the residential neighborhood that had in fact occurred in some of the neighborhoods with smaller lots. And so that provision was brought back in.
Thank you. Frank?
David's first. Dave? One issue that we've been hearing about from a few citizens is the number of cars that are being parked on some of these smaller lots. Is what the planning board has proposed, how does the planning board's proposal deal with that issue, if at all?
What we have said is that there has to be one parking space provided for every two tenants and for every two guests, and that that parking has to be either available on the lot or there has to be a formal arrangement for off-site parking. That would not prohibit parking on the grass. So if you have enough square footage for cars to be parked on the grass, that would count. But it does eliminate the possibility of 15 or 20 cars being parked on a very small lot, because there simply wouldn't be the square footage on that lot unless there was some kind of an off-site parking arrangement.
Thanks.
Frank?
Elaine, if an owner chose to maximize the rental of a unit under this ordinance, maximum that would be allowed, in a practical way, how would that home be any different than a B&B operation?
Well, you know, that's a very interesting question, and that's one of the things that was discussed, how this, if someone were to rent their home for seven-day periods, 52 weeks a year, it would be different from a B&B in that a B&B requires that there be a resident owner or manager on the property, and in this case, there would be no one. It could be a completely absentee landlord who rented out the property on a weekly basis all year round. So it could be in many ways like, oh, you know, people are responsible for their own food, there's no one there serving meals. Mm-hmm. That sort of thing would make it more like a B&B. So it's a similar use, and there was a lot of discussion of that.
Mm-hmm. Sir?
Yeah.
Elaine, what was the rationale for the minimum rental period of 7 days? Because I think that might have been a departure of the planning board. I'm assuming that a 1 or 2 day rental period then is not allowed.
A 1 or 2 day rental period is not allowed, and I think that was in response to the concern of sort of churning. How often are new faces appearing in the neighborhood? Mm-hmm. That was a compromise number. There were many people who wanted to be able to do 3 day rentals so that for a long weekend, a holiday weekend, they could rent the property, and that's a very important source of revenue. There were other people who felt really that any rental shorter than 14 days was just too short, because people would come into the property and they would party every single day. And that seems to be the kind of behavior that's most troublesome, because people come into a short-term rental, they're in vacation mode, and the level of activity is different than the level of activity in a typical residential neighborhood. And so it was kind of a way to draw a compromise between having, you know, the house become a constant party house.
Jim?
As you look at the nuisance ordinance, were there any particular pieces of it that you felt needed to be more robust or whatever in terms of putting some teeth into that aspect of this process?
Because the nuisance ordinance is beyond our jurisdiction, we did not look at the specifics of the nuisance ordinance at all. We simply acknowledged that much of the behavior we heard about had to do with noise, disturbing the peace, or things that you would, you know, using normal English, think might qualify as a nuisance or disturbance of the peace. And that generally is dealt with in a nuisance ordinance. The other thing we heard about, though, is that the way that the nuisance ordinance operates requires a specific complaint to be filed with the police department for each instance of disturbance, and that when you're talking about a residential neighborhood, that's not a very harmonious way for a neighborhood to operate if owners are constantly calling the police about their fellow neighbors. So there was some discussion about whether, well, you know, it's a three strikes and you're out sort of thing, that if there's a nuisance in your house a certain number of times, then maybe thereafter you can't do any short-term rentals. There were all sorts of thoughts, but in terms of putting that in the ordinance, that was really beyond our scope, so we didn't get that far.
Yeah. So, I mean, basically what I'm understanding from your recommendation is that you're going to extend the short-term rental period to 7 days. And I'm just going along with your thought about the nuisance ordinance idea. It seems to be that most of the complaints are nuisance-related issues, loud music, partying. So I'm just questioning how lengthening a stay is going to solve this. I mean, so every landlord or person who rents their house has to make their lease now 7 days. It doesn't stop the people that are renting the house for 7 days to come up for a long weekend and party and make all the nuisance problems that they've continued to have. So I'm questioning whether or not really this is necessary, or if just looking at the nuisance ordinance and tightening that up would actually be the most effective way to solve this problem without stepping on all the toes of all the other people that rent their homes that aren't having nuisance problems.
So can we hold that thought? Because that's like a problem-solving thought, which I think we should talk about. But I want to hear from everyone else first. Is that okay?
No problem.
Because I agree with you that that is sort of at the crux of, it's one of the cruxes of the issue. So can I thank you? And we
yes.
may have you back up with
thank
more
you.
Questions. But I think
okay.
it would be helpful to hear from everyone who wants to speak and then maybe have that kind of substantive discussion, or at least decide the process by which to have it.
Not a problem.
Great.
Thank you, Elaine.
You ready?
Ready.
Okay. Good evening. My name is Jenny Aronson, and I live at 27 Lawson Road. There's a serious problem in my neighborhood, which has been created by short-term rentals. I'm here to beg for your help in fixing the problem. We need laws on the books. Short-term rentals are destructive to the fabric of a small neighborhood. They destroy my sense of safety and security. They destroy my ability to utilize and enjoy my property. They destroy the value of my home. For more than 2 years, our neighbors, the Grennans and the Volans, have been suffering with this problem at their end of the street. And no one in this room understands how terrible and outrageous this has been for them, unless you've personally experienced it. And I had that experience starting the weekend of June 1st when 10 men drove up from Massachusetts in 10 cars for a 3-day bachelor gathering. And my fury and fear was compounded by outrage when a strolling neighbor informed me that number 31 Lawson Road is advertised on the internet for $1,000 a night or $4,000 for the week. Not by the owner, but by a subletter. Neither of them have ever lived in that house. It is a business. I don't live in the business district. I live in a residential district. As for safety and security, I don't want new strangers walking in my neighborhood every week, and I don't want their friends. Nuisance is not the only issue. There are plenty of well-behaved psychopaths. I don't need strangers casing out my homes and families on the street. This is a quiet, small, safe neighborhood. We don't need the whole world checking us out. As for using my property, I feel very uncomfortable and unsafe sitting on my deck or going down to the rocks or going down to the beach when there are groups of strangers there. Certainly, I would be tense out of my mind if my kids were still young and running around that neighborhood. As for destroying property value, I say good luck to the town of Cape Elizabeth, because this will bring my property value down and income from property taxes will go down.
There is currently nothing to stop a realtor or anyone from buying multiple houses on our street to be used for short-term rentals. I don't think there is a one-size-fits-all ordinance. Large properties or small properties without immediate neighbors can do what they want, as far as I'm concerned. But if this is my chance to ask for what I really want, then I'm going to tell you what I really want. And I want you to ban short-term rentals in small lot neighborhoods, as it has been done in other parts of the country. I'm keeping a written and photographic journal of what's happening next door to me at number 31 Lawson Road, and you're all welcome to see it at any time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Peter Clifford. I live at 36 Lawson, and I appreciate your attention here. I live on the other side of Jenny, and I can verify what she's talked about with the bachelor party. It was it was very disturbing. But I want to shift attention to a couple of pragmatic issues. The first is that I noticed just a second ago that the definition of bed and breakfast is for 14 days. I would respectfully suggest either a 30-day window for short-term rentals to keep the fabric of single-family neighborhoods intact, or at the very minimum, 14 days, because that seems to be a logical dividing line. If a bed and breakfast can be rented for up to 14 days, I don't see how you can actually allow less than that for residents.
Excuse me, I think actually a bed and breakfast, you could have a one-night stay at a bed and breakfast.
Yes, but I guess the 14 days is the maximum under, if I read this, ordinance properly. So to me, that 14-day window might be a bright line that at least would be consistent with what you've done in the past. But the other issue is just the definition of what nuisance is. And a little while ago, I did submit an email to the council to maybe suggest a couple of principles. And I think the drafting is going to be left to the council, obviously. But the biggest principle is that the owner is responsible for nuisances that take place during the short-term rental. And I think it's a one strike and you're out. If you define what a single-family use is in the nuisance ordinance, where you could say late-night activity, you've got to basically be quiet after a certain amount of time, just like everyone else would be. Basically zero tolerance for bachelor parties and things like that. And I would think that the owner would be responsible for making sure the tenants don't break that. And if the owner didn't do that, the owner would lose his license to rent on a short-term basis. Right now, I've heard a couple of complaints or issues from people around town saying, well, there's only been a few police calls. And the reason is that the current definition is so amorphous now. And like you've heard from others, no one really wants to call the police unless it's a crime, unless there's a public safety issue. And if it's loud noises, I think the tendency in our neighborhood is to simply let things go. We have a wonderful neighborhood. Dave Volan just had a neighborhood gathering for somebody that left. We love our neighborhood. I can't emphasize that strongly enough. And these small neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth are a treasure. I think it's not only our neighborhood, it's Trondy Point, it's Peebles Cove, it's basically most of the neighborhoods, and they're going to be destroyed or eroded if you allow these businesses to run. So the last issue I just want to say is, I think it's outrageous that somebody is subleasing these for money, and that's got to be outlawed at a bare minimum. So to summarize what I'm saying, I think a 30-day window for short-term rentals makes sense. The nuisance has to be tailored with language addressing short-term rentals. I did give draft language to the council a little while ago, and I'm happy to resubmit that. And then finally, it's got to, any business use has got to be eliminated. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Peter.
My name is Mary Volan. I live at 17 Lawson Road. From the beginning of this discussion, there has been an effort by some to trivialize the issue. It was merely a dispute between two neighbors, a noise issue, a parking issue. We need to just keep calling the police. This is a zoning issue, pure and simple. By allowing these transient lodging businesses to operate in residential neighborhoods, this ordinance, for better or for worse, will describe what it means to live in a residential neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth. It will describe neighborhood character, not just for residents, but for buyers, sellers, and lenders. Some years ago, I attended a board meeting. On the agenda, before the item of interest to me, a request for a home business was discussed. I remember because I was really tired, and the issue was being discussed at great length. A licensed physical therapist was going to see clients from 9 to 2. Clients would be scheduled so that only one car would be parked in her driveway at a time. There would be no signage. Abutters were invited to the meeting by letter to ask questions and make comments. I remember thinking, no harm, no foul, move on. I also remember feeling gratified that protecting our residential zoning was being taken so very seriously. Fast forward to our situation. Three lodging businesses are operating in our neighborhood 24/7, with potentially 40 or 50 transient individuals wandering on the beach, invading our privacy, and parking 20 to 30 extra cars on our narrow street. Here's what really galls me. In the past, the burden of proof was on the business seeking a permit. The business owner had to show that operating in a residential neighborhood would not create safety, traffic, or nuisance problems for the neighborhood. In our situation, the burden of proof seemingly has been on us. Prove that these businesses are a problem. I feel we talk and talk and talk, and no one is really listening. Call the police. Illegal fireworks are being shot off at 11:30 on a Thursday. Call the police. Intoxicated individuals on the beach are having altercations with our children. Call the police. Renters are packing the houses with more individuals than is safe. Call the police. Bottles and butts are being thrown on the beach. Call the police. Our street looks like a Walmart parking lot. Call the police. What a difference. Quality communities around the country desirous of maintaining a residential character have either banned short-term rental businesses or set limitations of at least 30 days. A week is too short. 16 is too many. The draft ordinance will not prevent the abuses we have documented. The ordinance, which practically speaking is a zoning change, will encourage transients, weaken the fabric of our neighborhoods, and eventually impact the quality of our schools. New families looking for a safe place to raise their children and invest their real estate dollar will begin to look elsewhere. Cape Elizabeth is not a seasonal recreational community. It is a residential community. The ordinance needs to support the character of the community. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, these comments have gone on for 4 minutes each, which I'm not objecting to people expressing their views, but...
We technically only have 5 more minutes, so depending on how many other people need to speak. Bear that in mind.
Charlie Weber, 105 Fowler Road. I own a seasonal rental property in Peebles Cove, at 30 Shipwreck Cove. I rent that property by the week. It's the house I grew up in. That whole community has been seasonal cottage rentals since it was created in the early 1900s. I moved there with my family in 1954. There were 30 cottages in that area. We were the only year-round residents at that time. Recently, the 24 of those cottages, the land has been sold. It was all leased land, and everybody owns their individual lots now. There's an association. We have a set of rules that governs how we rent
When I grew up, 60% of the cottages were rentals at that time. The other ones were, other than our house, were a seasonal cottage that people came to in the summer. It's a cottage community. It's not a great big mansion community on the ocean. We have very strict limitations on what we can do with our cottages as far as expansion. And I think so one size doesn't fit all. I understand the problems you're having in Lawson Road. A lot of the families that rented there rented by the week. A lot of those families have since moved to Cape Elizabeth. I have many friends that I grew up with that were seasonal renters that now have homes here. So I just basically don't think that you can just make one set of rules that fits every situation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Edwin Fitzpatrick, 28 Peebles Cove Road, next door to Charlie Weber. I think this is a draconian answer to a very limited problem. The problem, the people of Lawson Road have my very great sympathy. But as the representative of the planning board explained, they are very rare locations. They're very limited. And the planning board representative doesn't see this as the answer to the problem. She says they couldn't draft the kind of ordinance that could be needed. So perhaps the planning board shouldn't have had this in the first place. At a time when everyone is complaining about the intrusion of big government into our private lives, what we have here is a case of small government trying to impose on a whole town the problems that it should be solving in another way. I'd like to say about Mr. Weber. I've lived in my cottage, seasonal, for 41 years. And Charlie's family were the policemen of the cove. They were the only people who would tough it out in winter. They looked after the cove. They were the policemen. Mrs. Weber watched our property. If she saw anything suspicious, she called the police. Now, I will say that the police have been to Peebles Cove more often, probably, than to any other cove in this town. You know why? Because the Murrays live there. And the Murrays have been closely identified with the police, the fire brigade, the ambulance service. That's why they're there. Charlie has had to buy his land this year. He has been renting by the week. I am right next door, and I have been next door for years. I have never, ever known of one problem with that rental because they're responsible people. My other next door neighbor rents maybe twice a year. And I have another neighbor that rents perhaps twice or three times a year. No problems. I think this is not the answer to a terrible problem. I can't believe what I'm hearing from Lawson Road.
Can you wrap up, because it's been 3 minutes? Sorry.
I know, but they've had 20 minutes already. And so let's hear my side.
Well, I think hearing it.
I just think this is not a good answer. And this has to be tackled and it has to be solved, but not in this manner. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For your patience.
My name is Mary Giftis. I live at Six Point Road, which is part of the Lawson Road Pond Cove community. I have been affiliated with Cape Elizabeth since 1968. I've been a resident of Maine for 4 years. I purchased at great expense a piece of property in a residential community. And the existing conditions are not residential. I would have, I've invested personally, professionally, and fiscally in a residential community. I chose that over other suitable properties in Falmouth, Yarmouth, Cumberland, and Freeport. Quite honestly, had I known of this existing non-residential use of this community, I would have picked a different community. I feel my I'm concerned that my property value has diminished. That's it.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Tom Dunham. We have a cottage at 12 Becky's Cove Lane. Our primary home is 75 feet away at 11 Becky's Cove. And I am extremely sympathetic with people on Lawson Road. I thought Peter made some very good comments on if there's an issue and they call the police, then it's second time you're out. And I think, from my perspective, it's enforcement. And I would be extremely aggressive to those that are creating this nuisance. And you cannot regulate behavior. My wife and I have been to all but one of these meetings to discuss seasonal rentals. And it has been so difficult for the planning board and the ordinance committee to try to come up with a solution. There isn't one. It is police powers and is being very diligent. And I think a lot of the responsibility falls back on the neighborhood and the families speaking up and calling the police. And I don't care what time of day it is, call them and be vigilant and really be in their face, because I would never put up with this these families did the 1st of June. They have got to take some responsibility to be very aggressive. I think there was only one call made on that that weekend with the bachelor's party, and if it had been me, I would have been calling every half hour, and I would want results from the town manager and the police department. So I'm very sympathetic. The issue I have, as well being where we are, is the cottage was built in 1898. It's on 12,000 square feet. And I'm caught up into this, and I respectfully request that Sandy and I be exempt or waived if your residence is next to the home that you rent out. We have had no problems, and we are very diligent in screening our people. I guess they become friends. They come back frequently every year. It's a non-issue within our family, and if they were lacking decorum, I would be over there in 2 minutes. And this past couple of days, our windows are all open. I don't even hear them. And the nearest residence is about 400 feet away. So what troubles me is I'm kind of trapped into this process and very diligent, because I don't think you're going to be successful unless you pursue the nuisance ordinances and the police powers that are here in town. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dunn.
Good evening. My name is Jo Agnes Pasquarello, and I live in Peebles Cove. The town council must decide if they want Cape Elizabeth to be a residential community or a resort town, such as Old Orchard Beach. Short-term rentals create problems, not so much because the people are always doing something wrong, but by design. A few years ago, my friend's 80-year-old mother, who had a large 2-acre lot, approached the town about creating an apartment over her garage to house at most two people. She needed help with the $20,000 a year tax bill, as her husband had just passed away. The town denied her request because it would have created a multifamily unit. If the council allows and puts forward these rules that accept parties of 10 in a residential community, they are in effect creating duplex and triplex situations. Please think about the logistics of what you're suggesting. If I'm not mistaken, most homes in Cape Elizabeth house a family. Usually that consists of 2 to 5 or 6 people. I asked the council to think about their neighborhoods. Is it relatively quiet? Do people work? How many people are in the houses on either side of you? Now, up the number. Imagine a continuous flow of vacationers who are letting down, having fun, staying up late, and just shooting the breeze on the porch night after night. Are they doing anything wrong? Of course not. That is why we all, that's what we all do on vacation. Now imagine yourself in a clustered neighborhood such as Peebles Cove, where maybe 10 feet separates your house from your neighbors. For no other reason than this, the number of bedrooms in a short-term rental should not be a consideration in the number of people allowed, especially in a clustered community such as Peebles Cove. Please consider restricting the number of persons allowed in short-term rentals, maybe even the idea of a rental of less than 2 weeks. There is no doubt that short-term rentals are a business, and as such should be subject to strict guidelines that have consequences. This is not to say that large parcels such as Hidden Court and the Sprague Corporation land should not be subject to looser standards. I beseech the council to keep our town a residential community, continuing with the quality of living we have all been privileged to enjoy. Please do not make Cape Elizabeth a resort community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to close the one more, and then we're going to close the public hearing. Because I apologize, we've gone on to
David Boland, 17 Lawson Road. My wife Mary has already indicated, I think, the way I feel about the whole thing. But a couple things I wanted to bring up based on the comments we've heard already. First off, the 30,000 square foot rule, I think, is a misnomer, and here's where I agree with Tom Dunham. You could have a 500,000 square foot lot with a cabin way off in the corner, and if you're next to it, the 30,000 square foot has a cabin in it that is 500 yards from the other person, but that 30,000 square lot under this current ordinance would not be able to have a short-term rental. Seems kind of senseless, doesn't it? The other part that I have a problem with is relying on the nuisance ordinance and for us to call the police. This essentially means that we are faced with a situation where every time there is a change in tenants, we're going to be faced with a condition where we may have to call the police. That puts, an undue burden on us in the neighborhood to have to watch out for every single group of changed people that come in. And I think that's very unfair. I think the best way to cover this is to restrict the actual locations and use of the short-term rentals. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, one point, and then that's it.
Thank you very much.
Sorry to be so strict, but...
The Board of Directors of the Peebles Cove Association would like to submit the following statement regarding property rental within our subdivision as governed by the Peebles Cove Association Declaration of Covenants, Conditions, and Restrictions that were adopted on November 16th of 2011. Article 9, Section 3 states leasing one's property is limited to a minimum period of 1 week or longer and must be accomplished via a written lease agreement, which includes an attachment referring to our very complex neighborhood rules and regulations, plus the covenants, conditions, and restrictions that any renter in our neighborhood is required to follow. Property owners who do not adhere to these conditions are subject to disciplinary action through a very well-defined complaint and hearing procedure in our rules and regulations. Any tenant found to be in default of their lease agreement is subject to lease termination and, if necessary, eviction. To date, since we have adopted these rules and regulations in November of 2011, we have only had one inquiry regarding the length of the lease terms, and the Board of Directors responded and resolved that question quickly. I've provided here a copy of our covenants, conditions, and restrictions for your review. The Board wishes to express its unanimous confidence in the Peebles Cove District that renting within our neighborhood is well regulated by our own governing documents and does not require the additional intervention of town policies. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Very much. What?
She needs to identify herself to Deborah.
I'm sorry, can you tell us your name and address because for the minutes?
It's Penny Pollard, 3 Peebles Point Lane.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone who came out to speak. Really, I found that actually incredibly helpful, everyone's point of view, and much to think about and discuss. So I'm going to close the public hearing, and now let's start council discussion with a motion, if we could. Dave?
And I just want to clarify, it wasn't a public, I don't mean to be
I'm
like
sorry,
a real...
I'm sorry, it wasn't a public hearing. It was comments.
...member of the council, but we're going to have a public hearing later, I'm sure.
I apologize. The comments before the item on the agenda.
But the motion I'm going to make is originally we were contemplating sending this back to the ordinance committee, which would then have perhaps had a couple of meetings, sent it back to the council, and then we would have had a public hearing. And then my guess is that the council probably would want to tinker with it even more. So my suggestion and the motion I'm going to make is that we refer this to a workshop of the full council so that all seven of us can deliberate over what the planning board has sent to us, as well as the comments that we've been hearing tonight, as well as in all the emails leading up to tonight. Because I think we're going to get to that time anyway. So I would move that we forward the issue of short-term rentals to a workshop of the full council.
Second?
I'll second it.
So setting aside a discussion of this topic for a minute, can we just discuss the wisdom or lack thereof of Dave's suggestion that we hash this out, hopefully, for finally, as a full council? Frank?
So I think it's a good proposal to start thinking about, I guess, where would this lead us, in a sense? Is this substituting for what the ordinance committee would do? Do you see us as a council creating a new ordinance? What would this process lead to?
Essentially, it would be that the full council would act as the ordinance committee, and then would refer a proposed draft ordinance back to the council, at which time we would have a public hearing and we would vote. We did something along the lines of this when we dealt with the Tara property on Shore Road. It was a very contentious issue. It was actually an issue that was very limited in scope in terms of it affected really just one neighborhood. And we decided as a council to have the full council just deliberate over a proposed ordinance to change the zoning of one lot. And rather than go to the ordinance committee, come back to the council, and then inevitably get to another workshop, we just went right to a workshop. So it would be us essentially crafting an ordinance that then we would recommend to the council to consider at a public hearing.
And I guess one way to interpret this proposal is that we're starting from scratch.
I'm not saying, no, I mean, I think what we would be obligated to do, certainly the ordinance committee would review what the planning board has proposed, mm-hmm. decide whether we like that or we don't like that. I suppose an option would be, as a council, we decide, hey, we don't like any of these things. We're going to start all over again. But if that's what happens with the council, I'd rather not sit through, no offense, two or three ordinance committee meetings, only to come back to the council and have the rest of the group say, I don't like what you guys have done, let's just start all over. I'd rather just get to that point.
Probably the most expeditious approach.
And just, I like it. I like the idea because it's conceivable that the answer to this does not lie in crafting an ordinance, and this frees us up from that lens, right?
Sure.
This is going to be, this goes back to a problem-solving brainstorming session, which I actually think is the appropriate venue for it. An ordinance committee has to look at it in the context of being an ordinance. So we may or may not recommend an ordinance to the ordinance committee, right? We might, who knows what we'll do. But anyway, we'll at least have everyone's voice on it. Do we want to pick a date? Oh, well, does everyone think this is a good idea?
Jessica?
I wanted to hear what Councilor Walsh's thoughts are.
Well, other than not having members of my ordinance committee under control, I would say, we made a decision to move this to the meeting that we were planning in June, rather July 17th, as opposed to waiting to the end of the month. We planned that it was going to take at least two meetings, possibly three. And we've already started to think about the nuisance issue and to really try to, because we need to delve into that question as well. You know, this is essentially fast-forwarding this process to get the entire council weighed in. Frankly, you have two bodies that have looked at this subject at in considerable length. The diversity of opinion you heard tonight, you could multiply 10 times for what the planning board listened to and what wasn't talked about, the number of emails we've all received, as well as the four meetings we had. In one of our meetings, we had 100 people at the fire station. So, you know, I'm inclined to say let's go to a workshop and let's move this along. But I got to tell you, I mean, I think it's, I'm anxious to have all of you weigh in, because, again, what David is suggesting is we could be spending three meetings coming back and then having a group of seven then wish to go to a workshop again. You know, so why not just go right to that workshop? Again, I'm all for getting this done and doing the right thing, and I'm more than happy to support Councilor Sherman's decision to move this directly to workshop.
Any further discussion? Well, I mean, I'm inclined to support that too, as long as we're not shortchanging ourselves on information that the ordinance committee might want to give us now, having received formally the planning board's. I mean,
Well, Jessica,
and maybe they could do something.
Well, Jessica,
I know,
just,
but,
an interesting point. The planning board brought to us the building code safety issues and did an absolutely fabulous job of focusing that portion of this ordinance. We spent a lot of time sort of wallowing around about how far do you go. And one of the ordinance, or one of the planning board members, who's an architect, spent a great deal of time honing in on those issues as they related to what we might require. Now again, you know, whether that's the right thing or the wrong thing. So there's a lot of good work that was done at the planning level. And I think with what we have at the ordinance level at the moment, and that input now from the planning board, plus the continued public comment that we get, and input that we receive by email, I think the workshop can be a good avenue for our next steps.
Okay. So, Frank.
I think for the process to be most productive, I think it would be beneficial if the ordinance committee created a structured agenda, topics that we need to address, so we move forward on a methodical way. I also think that one thing we need to make sure we avoid or be conscious of is end up in a situation like the planning board had, which the outcome of it was nothing, was a recommendation which no one fully really supported, but it was the best they could do. Otherwise, we're going to end up just spinning our wheels.
I mean, I envision that this essentially would be an ordinance committee meeting that the entire council participates in. Therefore, I mean, I don't get too wrapped up in who runs meetings, but it would seem to me that, similar to what I think we did with Tara, that issue, that Jim, as ordinance chair, would actually run the meeting. He would perhaps coordinate with the planning board to ensure that we have the chair and maybe Mr. Shalott attend, so they can give us information. Yeah. And we can also coordinate with the town planner to see what additional information we may need. And we've heard a lot about the nuisance issue. Maybe we need to get some more background there, but we can certainly use all the resources that the ordinance committee would normally have. Only we just have seven of us instead of three.
Yeah, the only other thing that has to be clear to the public, that in a workshop, what participation will the public have? I mean, it's a very different place for discussion.
I think my sense is that obviously it's public and anyone can attend who wishes to, but I'm not sure there's much time for citizen input meeting.
Right.
And but it's not. Whatever comes out of that meeting is going to have a public hearing.
Right.
Sure.
But that
we would just recommend it to.
Right. But the workshop session itself is going to be for the seven of us. I think it's real important for the public to understand that, because up to now, every meeting, other than a few planning board meetings, the public has had input into the discussions. And I just want to be clear that if we go to this workshop concept, and I have no problem with that being chaired and having a structured agenda with the necessary pre-work for each one of us, so that we come in completely prepared and understand what the issues are and what the options are, so we can get some clarity around where we're headed as a council.
So we usually have workshops the first Monday of the month, often? Tuesday? Help me out.
It varies.
Oh, okay. So September 5th is our next scheduled one. If we were to do the comparable date in August, it would be the 6th. Is it, are too many people gone in August to make that meeting, or are folks here?
I'm here.
I'm here.
Everyone's here in August? So is it people's pleasure that we set this for August 6th, which is a
Monday.
Monday night at 7?
Let's do that.
Where are we meeting, in that room?
We need to confirm its availability.
Okay, well, that will be announced.
Could I make one quick comment?
You may.
I know you're discussing the process, but I'm looking at this 31 Lawson Road. I've looked at it while, unfortunately, he just left the owner of it. I'll say what I was going to say anyway, so I wanted to say it to him. I'm looking this online at homeaway.com, vacation rental. As was said by a citizen, per night, $1,000, per week, $4,000. I looked at our property records. It's owned by a limited liability corporation. You know, no matter what one's position is on this issue, there is someone who is totally abusing the privilege of living in a neighborhood, of owning property in a neighborhood. And, you know, this takes time to work. You know, everyone, you know, we've been getting emails even during the meeting that says it's only one neighborhood. It's, you know, there are other neighborhoods. But for someone to be renting a property and advertising it for a single night for $1,000 when no one lives in it, and when it's owned by a limited liability corporation, and when they know all these issues are going on, to me it's the most in-your-face reaction to the citizens of this neighborhood, to the town, and for those that care about renting their properties for vacation rental. So, you know, that, you know, unfortunately he just left, the owner of that property. But, you know, I was hoping he was going to be here to hear this. Because, you know, if he doesn't, and his, that limited liability corporation, doesn't clean up their act, you know, I think the council ought to consider an emergency ordinance to deal with that one property, to prohibit the types of activities going on there, the single night rentals, and the other things that clearly are a business. And, you know, it's totally out of hand, that property. There are other issues, there are other problems. But that particular property, you know, if we continue to get police calls that are legitimate in the next month, I think the council really needs to consider something to throw some regulatory, the ability to have some regulatory enforcement on the one property. It's totally out of hand. It's in your face what they're doing. And I think it's destructive to anyone what that resident, that property owner is doing. They're not a resident. What that property owner is doing to anyone who cares about this issue, no matter what side of the issue they're on. Thank you.
Chair, if I could echo the town manager's comment, I know we've heard from a lot of people in Lawson Road, and I've had email exchanges with them encouraging them to raise complaints with the police and the council, and actually I appreciate the fact that Jenny has been sending us emails. I guess I would encourage you to stop being so nice and understanding, and you don't want to ruin the bride's wedding day. Well, go ahead and just, because in my view, you're handing an argument on a silver platter to people in town saying, hey, there's not an issue, there aren't any complaints, but we need, if you feel there's a nuisance and you feel they're breaking the ordinance or the law, call the police, please.
David, just a quick one on that. I took Jenny's note to us, and I actually sent it to Neil Williams, the chief of police, and I had him send a police car down Lawson Road. And the reason I did that is because Jenny used the word casing the neighborhood, and that's what she used for language. To me, if that doesn't raise itself to the level of calling the police, nothing does. If you even remotely suspected that they were casing the neighborhood, you'd call. And again, it's not the answer, but it's certainly encouraging people to use the facilities that we have here in Cape Elizabeth, and one of them is the police department.
But it is a difficulty when there's new, fresh faces every few days, which a few people have made that point. It doesn't. I agree with you. It gives us a little teeth, but it in no way does it solve the problem. And am I allowed to call on people again? I'm not sure you're allowed to. Was it your experience with trying to call the police and that it didn't?
Tell her to come up.
Tell her to come yes, up. But I, you, but you, sorry, you have to go back up to the podium. So you're on camera. Yes, please.
I have a hard time with this entire conversation. I support the statement of Mary Volin, and I will make my own statement. My name is Mary Giftis. I live at Six Point Road. I will always be nice, no matter what. That's my right. You are a town council. It is your job to correct an obvious wrong. I have done no wrong. It is not my job to change my personality. I think this is reversed. I appreciate what you're saying, Dave. I just think it's inverted. It's not my responsibility to change my character.
But no matter what ordinance we pass, if you have a bad actor, let's just say we ban short-term rentals in this neighborhood, and you have a bad actor who starts doing it anyway, your neighborhood is going to have to report it to somebody. This just can't, in a vacuum,
Mike McGovern.
I'm cutting off the conversation.
The reality.
This is going to be part of the conversation, Dorisha. I apologize.
I will sit down.
I hear what both people are saying, and this is part of a much larger conversation that hopefully we will be part of the workshop, because it gets to the heart of one of the many, many issues that we need to struggle with some more. So, shall we vote? All those in favor of Dave's
motion.
Thank you. To refer this motion, that was the word I was missing, motion to refer this to a workshop on August 6th at 7 o'clock. All those in favor? Opposed? Awesome. Thank you all for coming out. I apologize that this has been an extremely protracted process, but thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
Item 109, 2012 property boundary surveys. Do I have a motion?
So, should we let people leave?
No, that's the Deneen property.
I see Deneen. I see picture Kevin Deneen here on it.
That's what Deneen rented last year. Patty's is a whole different
property. But is...
Who owns that place? It's sold.
Some limited liability corporation.
They know the name.
I think it's this one.
You think so?
I think so.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
okay.
I think it is.
Okay, item 109, 2012. Do I have a motion?
Okay, the town...
I apologize. Do you guys mind talking outside?
Okay, the town council...
So we can continue.
The town council thanks the ordinance committee for reviewing the issues related to property boundaries and refers to the planning board the review of the ordinance committee's proposal. And you have a memo from the ordinance committee giving you the background. This relates to less than a year ago, we dealt with a property boundary issue that the town council had to get involved in. Basically, this involved a property where was within 5 feet of the property line. We have a lot of communities in our town that have those types of restrictions. This would involve building permit of $10,000. It would only get triggered at $10,000 that we would then request and require within that 5 feet. We would require a boundary survey. Up to now, we've not been formalized in this regard, and the ordinance committee spent a couple of meetings reviewing this and feels that we need to formalize it and present it to the planning board for their review, and then come back to the town council to determine whether, in fact, this is to be done. Up to now, we've really avoided asking the applicant to spend a couple of thousand dollars to actually get a boundary survey. It's been up to now. It's been a Class D mortgage survey or a handwritten survey based on where people feel the meets and bounds are located. We talked to professional survey companies
We discussed the actual definition of a boundary survey. We looked at other forms of survey to determine how we could best get the answer to the question as to where this particular property is being located within that 5 feet without adding an unnecessary financial burden to the applicant. The determination was made that that a boundary survey is the appropriate way to go. Within this particular ordinance that we're handing to the planning board, we do have some latitude on the part of the code enforcement officer to ask for a single boundary or two boundary lines as opposed to four. So there could be some cost savings depending upon what the actual application is for. So I'd ask you to agree to send this to our planning board, and I thank my fellow ordinance committee members for their diligence on this.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? Jessica?
I think it's a very good idea. And I think that even though it, you know, it's always of concern when you're adding costs, the idea that you could just possibly get one line boundary on the line in question or the side in question done at a much reduced cost is very encouraging. The other part of this is that that this ultimately could save a great deal of money in the long run. We certainly all have heard of many situations where somebody wants to do something. Legal surveys are obtained, and there are multiple issues causing far more money than we're talking about here. So I think this is well worth studying.
Other comments? Just like to thank the Ordinance Committee once again for all your hard work. Thank you, Chair, Ordinance Chair, for all those in favor? Unanimous. Item 110, this has to do with the MMA Legislative Policy Committee, and thank you, Kathy Ray, for being our representative. Does this need a motion?
It needs approval, so we can sign the name in again.
Okay. Do we have to make a motion for approval, then?
You should.
Okay. Can I have a motion? Jessica?
Sure. I move that we confirm the town's representative for the next biennium to the MMA Legislative Policy Committee. That is Kathy Ray.
Seconded.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you, Kathy. Item 111 is just the status update on the 2012 Town Council goals. Is there a motion?
Sarah?
Yep.
I just have a question. I wonder, is there a way that we could add a, I don't call it a disclosure or something on the document that states that these can be modified at the discretion of the council, because we did get feedback about having a goal relative to the library stated in our goals that we were quoted and essentially brought to the woodshed on. And I would just like to make sure that people understand that things change. You know, the year can change, finances can change, priorities can change, and there's some way to include in there that these are clearly our expectations, but we could in fact have a priority change or a modification to a goal, and it isn't that we haven't abandoned what we originally set out to do, it's just that there's new information. I don't know how you do that, but it's just a thought.
Kathy?
And town council members can change.
And town council members can change. But I think the word goal implies process. It's not saying it's our mandate. It's saying it's our goal.
As our English major in residence, I appreciate that. However, we did have some feedback that quoted us as determining what we were going to do about the library. So just a thought. That's all.
I think that's maybe the first time anybody ever quoted one of our goals back to us since I've been on the council. But I tend to agree with Sarah. I think goal is, it's aspirational. I think it's inherent that the end result might be something different. So I don't know. It just seems like you put a little disclaimer at the bottom of our goals. It starts to sound a little milquetoasty, like, oh, but we might change our mind. It's sort of, what's the point of?
Well, that's part of the process of reviewing it, right? We're reviewing it now. If you want to strike one or change one or.
No.
Go. Have at it.
I have no problem with that concept going down in flames. Thank you.
So, do we have a motion?
Do we?
We need a motion.
Yeah, I move we accept our updated set of goals and work plan for 2012 with good discussion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you, Mike, for keeping us on task. Hopefully, by the end of the year, we'll have them all done.
Just if I might, there is a goal that we haven't made any progress on, review fundraising policy, municipal property projects and programs. Usually with a goal that there's sort of a council champion, either formally or informally, that sort of agrees that they'll work with the staff to help prepare, help prepare something so that it can be considered. And I, to be honest, I forget if there's, if there's someone who's really interested in that goal that we ought to be working with.
Can you, Jim, you want to do that?
Well, yeah, because at Fort Williams, we have the Arboretum, we have the mansion, we have the battery, we have the foundation. We have probably, if there's a vested interest in having clarity around this, it's probably the Fort Williams group. So I'm more than happy to volunteer. I'd had to make amends for that last motion, so I'll put myself out there.
Because you don't have enough work yet, Jim, on the council, so. Yeah. It'd be great with me if you want to do it.
With citizens' discussion before this last item.
Okay. Okay, so do we vote? All those in favor? We voted. It's unanimous. Great. So finally, citizens, I apologize for making you wait so long. Citizens, again, there's an opportunity for citizens to comment on items that are not on the agenda. So if any of you have been patiently here for that, you want to come forward now?
Okay, welcome to our world.
That's not how we would describe it, but thanks.
Is there a protocol for speaking? I didn't realize it was going to be cut off. Yeah. So I feel people who were aggressive in the podium and have a complete
I'll give you a copy.
I apologize, and I should have reviewed it more before. Essentially, when we have a public hearing on an issue, it's unlimited, and any number of people can come up, although it's always limited to 3 minutes. This was not technically a public hearing because the topic was not quite really ready for that, but there, we recently built in that we would allocate 15 minutes before every, because people were really frustrated that they couldn't speak at all. And I went way over the 15 minutes, but that is technically what we're supposed to do. And so at some point, I just sensed that the council was getting restless because we'll be hearing more. I apologize if you wanted to say something and missed your opportunity. You can always email us. Okay, so we need to go in executive session, item 112. Do I have a motion? Jessica?
I move that we... do we have to adjourn? We have to
no.
adjourn?
No. No. No.
Okay.
No.
I move that we go into executive session for item 112.
Seconded.
All those in favor?
I think we're about to exit.
Thank you.
It should be done by now.